And I was very much into the pre-Christian history and all the saints and all the mystics and so forth. So in the 80s, when I stumbled on the Aramaic language, that was the key for me to reopen the New Testament and the whole story of Yeshua and Mary the Magdalene. And I must also stress that from now on, every time I talk about Yeshua, I'm talking about Mary the Magdalene. And every time I'm talking about her, I talk about Yeshua. They are inseparable. So, and I'll come back to that. But so my book is actually built up on two very old practices. You may have heard about the Merkabah practices, the chariot of fire practice, which is to a certain limit known to a very few people, because it consists of seven lines and only the six of them are available to practice. So you really miss the whole thing if you haven't got the seventh lines. And being aware of that, the Essenes were, their only purpose was to pave the way for their Messiah or for the teacher of righteousness. So when you know that prayer or that practice of the six first lines, you know that the seven, what the seven line must be. But you can read all about it in my book, because it will take some studying and practicing, exactly like the Dalai Lama tells us that you must share your spiritual life in studying and practicing, studying and practicing. The one without the other takes you nowhere. So meeting the seer, it was very, very, to me, it was fantastic to see that here's a man who have never read anything, but he was practicing exactly what you can find in the New Testament. He didn't knew anything about Christianity, and he didn't really know anything about Jesus or whatever. And because he only knew the Jesus of the church, he had a very, very, that was one of his issues. That was the Catholic Jesus. So when I told him about that there was a Jewish Yeshua, he was really taken by that, and it took him some time to find out that Yeshua was the real thing, while the other one was a kind of fabricated person that had been kind of taking the real person's place. So to find out that this man was practicing something from the New Testament that he knew nothing about, it told me that, and to find out that he was practicing something that he had never heard about, never read about, it said to me that there is actually something within us and around us that are possibilities for us to connect wherever we want to. So he was also a man of about town. He had a lot of issues in his personal life, but every time he went into his so-called professional state, he could help people. You know, when I show my documentary on him, people see him actually sitting there smoking cigarettes, drinking wine, and they come to me after they have watched the film, being very fascinated, but also a little bit shaken, because how can he be a holy man? How can he be a holy man, drinking and smoking? And I have to tell those people, he never claimed to be a holy man. But despite that, he helped thousands of people. Also imagine that half a year before I actually met that man, that was half a year after he got me out of bed, I had half a year to build up a huge image of a so-called holy man. I mean, he was larger than life to me. He was a half god, because he got me out of 3 years of just lying there. So when I actually met him, the first morning we had to share breakfast, he opened the fridge. I've been a vegetarian for all my life, since I was 18 years old. So he opened the fridge and he drew out a can or tin of small sausages and some ham salad. You know, that was the first crack in that image, you know. And he was looking over like me, like I was sick or something. Aren't you going to have something proper to eat? And when he started doing the smoking thing and the wine thing, that picture was completely, it was gone, you know. So I had to start all over again. And I think too many people nowadays, when they start on this path and go, and they come into the so-called spiritual society, we have so many images within us how to be right, or what is wrong, and what is perfect, and what is not, and you know, we just continue in a way what the church have been doing for 2,000 years. And there's also nowadays a huge kind of priesthood within this so-called spiritual society that is setting the rules and are behaving like, you know, they were kind of messiahs or something. I mean, we are all, in the end, we are assholes, you know. That is that. We are here, we are incarnated here for a reason, yes. And we have a lot of personal issues. And if we hadn't, we wouldn't be here. So this is about acceptance. This is about to accept who we really are and why we are here, what we are doing here and where we are going, where do we come from. In the old mystery school, the Essenes knew exactly that everything must one day return to its origin. And everything we send out must return to us someday. Maybe not in this lifetime, but in some lifetime it will return to us. And if everybody knew that simple rule, just think about what a wonderful world we would be living in. But so far it's not so, it's not like it is, but we are still in a kind of kindergarten, trying to look for the next step, take the next step. Another thing that was very useful for me working with the seer was that we pupils, we were two girls and I, and we learned how to be invisible. How to be invisible. And how do you become invisible? You must first learn to be visible, or else you cannot learn to be invisible. If you want to be silenced, you must learn how to speak before you can be silenced, you know? So being invisible really means that you can go into communion of people, be at the exact symbol and look each one of them deeply in the eyes without them knowing you being there. Why? Because you don't claim anything. You don't claim to be this or that. You don't need any appreciation for those being there, because you know exactly who you are, and you know that everybody else are coming from exact same place. Maybe not in this lifetime, but it doesn't matter, because in the end we are coming back to where we all came from when everything started. So becoming invisible is really not something you do like this, because you really need to understand you don't need anybody's approval of you doing what you're doing or being the one you are. Yes? Just think about what kind of freedom that is. And that was exactly what Yeshua and the Magdalene was teaching. Exactly that. The last initiation that Yeshua had, and probably also the Magdalene, was when he came from Heliopolis in Egypt with his teacher, Judith Mara, Judith the Master, who had been his teacher since he went to his 12th year, he went to Carmel, the Essene school at Carmel, and then he went to Heliopolis to the Essene school there, and then he returned to Qumran at the Dead Sea, where John was baptizing him, and then he went to the 40 days in the desert. Maybe you remember it, 40 days in the desert. That was taking place just before he went out on his mission and was married to the Magdalene at Cana. So the 40 days in the desert is a very, very important initiation, because it is like you're going out in the desert, or not exactly in the desert, it's just a metaphor for putting yourself in an unprotected place, a state. Unprotected state. Just imagine if you go out in a real desert, there's nowhere you can hide. And that's exactly what this is all about. Many years ago from now, I was in Montségur, the holy mountain where I had my initiation. And it happened to me one day after that, one of the last initiations, that I had contact with some light beings. And my first question was, tell me, how are we, when are we finished just looking for God everywhere? We are looking and looking and looking and searching and searching, and he seems to be nowhere. And the answer came promptly. If man would step out of his or her hiding, then maybe God could find man. Yes? So that told me that, what is that hiding? What is this all about? It's about all the noise that we create, all our fears, all our worries, all our, you know, how it is to be a human fucking being. Sorry, my friends. But if we can just step out of all this noise and just get rid of it, transform it or whatever, that is why spiritual practices are necessary. And it is actually up to each one of us to pick the one that we find the most appropriate for us. Because you have to take responsibility for you. My experience are my experiences. Yours are yours. Yes, we can read books, and I continue to say that every time I'm here, that books won't do it, you know. That you cannot just take a book out here and learn how to ride a bike. You must hop on the bike yourself. But the traffic rules are here, all right, somewhere, some of them, very few of them maybe. And afterwards, it's also your, it's your kind of what you call responsibility to find the right traffic rule that you are going to ride your bike on. So, to start to take responsibility for ourselves is really what it's all about. And that was, in the end, that was why Yeshua actually was crucified. Because he and his lady were now spreading and sharing all the teachings from the mystery schools that up to then had been only for the few, the very few. Now it was given to everybody. And it have been here ever since, and only a few seem to be interested to pick it up. But now it is here, and we have to accept it and take responsibility for it. And because he did that in equality with a woman, that was exactly the last drop. And he ended
remember
up
what he said,
because this is also about knowing in what environment we are in. For example, about the Akashic records, how very important that is. And if I have to use a metaphor and use the seer as a metaphor now for what I'm going to tell, he very often, when people phoned him in the morning, he said, sorry, do you mind me just go out before time and space to read your records? And of course people, they said, no, this is going to take a very long time. You know, be out before everything was created, that's far away. No, it isn't, because it's just part of our being, you know? We have our physical being, and then we have our light body. And if you remember that Yeshua told us in the Gospel of Luke that the kingdom of heaven was within you, and in the Gospel of Thomas he continues and says, and everywhere around you, yes? And kingdom of heaven in Aramaic being Malkuta Deshemaya, the Shem of Deshemaya. Malkuta means kingdom, Deshemaya means heavenly. So if you take the Shem, that is actually, you could say, the identity mark of God in each and every one of us. And the Ayah, the Shem Ayah, the Ayah means which is forever. That is an eternal principle within us and all around us. So we are talking about the etherical world around us. We are in the middle of it. We are actually part of it, because it can sometimes be very hard to see where does your personal light being stop and the etherical world begins. This is something that is always moving. And when the day it stops moving around you, we are not here anymore. So you can be assured, as long as you are here, you are in connection with the etherical world. It's a very, very important knowledge to have, because now you can actually start reaching out for it. And it's part of your, it's all about consciousness. So everything is within reach, everything. It's just a matter of you accepting and starting to work with it. The whole angelic world, the archangels or whatever, all those energies are part of your light being. So spiritual work is actually freeing yourself from the noise so you can start communicating with these energies right here and now. And if somebody comes and try to complicate a very simple thing, you just have to turn your back because to it, because that is not so. It's so simple. It's just we it seems that human beings have an urge to complicate everything, and it has to be exclusive, it has to be secret, it has to be something that make me special, you know? Bullshit. We are already special. We are enlightened beings, and now we have to wake up and accept it, and try and start to act like we are enlightened beings. This is the challenge. And the board upstairs, they are just waiting for each one of us to pick the challenge up and go and do what we each one of us are here to do. Because in the old mystery school, they knew everything. They knew this was part of being in the mystery school, to have knowledge about where you came from, what you are doing here, who you was, and where you were going. And if you don't know these things, I mean, I'm sorry to say that Watkins Bookshop, you cannot read a book in here and find out why you are here and where you are. It's all part of your own being. And we need to start to have trust in our own inner voice. Because as the seer said, if you don't trust your intuition, it won't trust you. And it is like, for example, if every time you turn the GPS on, and I do it very often, and end up the most mystical places. But every time we do it, we are turning our own inner GPS down. And just think about it. The more different electronic gadgets that we are surrounding ourselves with, it is like we have no trust in ourselves and our intuition anymore. Yes? So this is about choice. What do we choose? We have the free will to choose whatever we want. That was part of the gift when we were born in the image of God. Yes? So we have this eternal force within us, each and every one of us. If it wasn't so, you wouldn't be here. So now we have to just bow down, pick it up, and start using it. And of course, when you have to learn to ride a bike, you fall off sometimes, and it hurts, and you get back on up, and you start, until one day you can actually ride that bike. It isn't more complicated than that. Thank you very much. And of course, when we have had other lifetimes somewhere else, remember that Jesuit always said, remember my father's kingdom has many mansions. Meaning there's other planes of consciousness, there are other universes, and so forth. So maybe you have never been here before. You come from somewhere else. And like I, when I came here in the beginning of this lifetime, I felt so estranged being here. And one of the first things I asked my mother and I said to my mother was, I thought that everything here was so primitive. And she was really thinking about that for a long time. What did he mean by that, you know? And a lot of youngsters are coming in now who have never been here before. And the only thing we can give them is a whole range of diagnoses, ADHD, and, you know, that's what we can offer them, you know? And they are actually here to help us taking the next step out of the mess we have created. So everything we have created, that is the prison that we are in right now. But we have always the possibilities to step out. It's just to do it. And we start today. That's my... 500 years ago, people that went into a monastery in order to take the next step. But we are not living 500 years ago. Now it's now, and there's no monasteries really anymore. So we are practicing in everything we do. When you do the dishes, when you go and do the groceries, it starts there. It's part of everyday life. It's the way we talk to each other, the way we look each other in the eye. It's about that yes we give each other every time. When I look at you, I look actually at myself. And you might find that not so very good, but that's how it is, you know. I see spirit. That's what I see. It comes in all shapes and colors, and I mean, we are all here for the same thing. So you can actually practice everywhere, in Trafalgar Square, while it's hell-like down there right now, you know. But you can always, you see people everywhere, and you communicate. You commune with yourself, you commune with God, every time you commune with another people. You can pray in the supermarket, you can do healing in the supermarket. You go to a sore spot in this town, you sit down on a bench and you just start doing your thing, and you will see like ripples. You can change the whole thing just by directing your spiritual force to it. Why should you do it? For the common good. Because it seems that everything's stressed, everybody is tied up, and we can actually do something to it. You can change things by just applying a prayer or meditation. Send it out from the heart.
So that's what's available in you.
Yes, it is.
Going somewhere.
Everybody, we all know that when we start doing these things, there's a little voice somewhere, oh, you cannot do that, and it's blasphemous to do this, or whatever we are carrying around with us. And we have just to step out of all this and just do what we are supposed to do. And we can actually buy books of prayers, but you are a prayer in yourself. And we can turn everything we do into a prayer, a healing prayer, and we can see the result immediately, instantly. It's just about doing it. I think if there was any tradition he was connected to, it was the hermetical tradition. But he said, I don't know who sent me, but I have to just do what they say. And he called them the board upstairs.
He calls them?
The board upstairs.
The board. Oh.
Yeah, yeah. Lying in bed for 3 years because I was going down the wrong path. Mm. I was not doing what I was supposed to do. And then I met the seer, and he got me out of bed. And then the real deal was going on, because it was all about how to be present and how to be exactly there. He said he was talking about elegance. He was talking about to be precise. You know, the first time I had to meet him in Spain, I was staying at a small hotel, and I was supposed to meet him 10 o'clock in the morning, and I was really sharp, and I was water in the hair, and boom, boom. 10 minutes to 10, I was there, zzzzt. No answer. Long, long time. Then he came to the telephone. Yes, he said. Yes, it's Lars, I said. Yes, he said. And I say, should we not? We were meeting at 10 o'clock, yes. Yes, it's 2:08, he said. So I had to wait 8 minutes before he opened the door. And in the beginning, I thought that he was completely rigid, or what kind of military man is this? But he said, if you cannot be precise here in this life, how do you reckon you can be precise there? Yes. And it took me some years to understand what he was talking about. And it is about being there when you're called for. If you come 5 minutes later, it's all gone. And it's happening around us now, right now. And it happened right when we came into this life, and it will follow us until we leave it. So why don't we just pick it up? The ether, the Akashic records, it records everything that we are saying, everything we are giving energy, everything, feelings. So it's so important that we try to create alignment between what we are thinking, saying, and doing. And you know all about how hard that can be. But every time we don't succeed, we just create noise around us. And we want to be polite, we want other people to love us, and that is why we won't really say who we are. But in the New Testament, Yeshua is saying, say yes when you mean yes, and no when you mean no. How difficult can that be? Very difficult, I tell you. But this is the challenge, and we need to accept it and take it. By the Zarathustra movement, and they were the ones who wrote the New Testament, or the Q manuscript of the New Testament. They are the only one who is not mentioned in the New Testament. Yep. The Pharisees and the Sadducees are.
No, Zarathustra.
No, because they were a secret society,
yep,
more or less. Yes, or whatever happened within that society belonged to them. They were very well known to the common people, because common people always went to them every time they needed help. And that was another thing that pissed the Pharisees and the Sadducees off. So there was always this tension, but they knew all about what we are talking about now here. You know, this was part, in many ways they were quantum physics. Very, very advanced quantum physics, 2,000 years before that, or 2,500 years before that, even became something we know about. And not as weird theories, but as facts built on practices and experience. Because they were not just sitting by desks, thinking, having thoughts about this or that. They were actually doing it. They were communicating with the ether and the Akashic records, or the Book of Life, as they call it. So the Book of Life is not something far away from us. We are part of it when we incarnate here. It's actually part of our light body. Yeah. So we are always access to those information about everything there. It's just about that between us and that, we have created a lot of noise, and that is what we are trying to get rid of by doing practice, spiritual practice, Akashic Records. You're reading the Akashic Records without knowing it. We all can, and we all do. But doing it consciously, that is the next step, because it takes us to step into a period going out in the desert and being invisible. Because in many ways we are too taken by the one we were supposed to, we should be, in order to satisfy all other people, our parents and, you know, around us. We need to find into that core of who we really are. Because some of the noise is also what other people think that you are, and you start believing that is what you should be, you know. There's too many norms in any society that we absolutely don't need to spend any time, waste our time with. Those who are caught up by all these rules, forget about it. Remember Yeshua, he was dining and wining with tax collectors, thieves and prostitutes. Yes? To such an extent that he got all the priests on his back, you know? He was in a fight with the Pharisees almost all his life, you know. So it tells us that we don't need to spend any more time, because our time here on earth are only 5 minutes, you know, seen in the whole perspective. Yes. So why? So, and there is a certain reason for us to be here right now. So that is why we need to go and. Reading the Akashic Records and being more aware of how to commune with the Akashic Records, that is also part of the step we have to dare take now. Because there's some really important information for you there, and for everybody, one of us. And we get them sometimes drop by drop, a drop here, a drop there, but usually we haven't got the we aren't there that we can connect the dots. And spiritual work is actually really about connecting the dots. And suddenly we can see the whole picture. And that's the wow. That's the closest I can come. But But yes, we are reading the Akashic Records, the Book of Life. Yes, they didn't execute women, they stoned them. But the whole fuss was about him, you know. Also because some of the disciples, for example Simon Peter, didn't want to have to create much attention around her because he was envious of her. So he just wanted to get rid of her. And the best thing was just to eliminate her influence, and that was what they did. And from the moment when she declared that she had seen her beloved in a vision raising from the dead, from that moment and 325 years on, there was actually a character murder going on her. A moon priestess became suddenly a prostitute, a simple whore. That was the business they had.
But was that all almost like preordained before they incarnated?
No, not actually. But you know, we have free will and you take choices, and sometimes you take the wrong choice. Yeah? But I think everything went as it was supposed to do. Yeah? Because we had to learn the hard way. But now we are here so many years later, and now I think the time has come for us to pick it up. No, I went to Israel when I was 17 years old, when I was playing in a band, and we went to do a 3-month tour there. And that was, you know, I already started my studying there. And suddenly it dawned on me that one day you were playing a gig in Nazareth, the next day you were in Bethlehem and you were in Jerusalem. And then you said, oh, maybe that somebody wants to tell you something. So when I came to Qumran of the Essenes the first time, we had a day off, and we were taken there as part of a tourist tour or something. And the guide, he just showed us around the old university of the Essenes there. And he said, and there was the scholarly, and there was this, and there was that. And suddenly I heard myself said, in a very small voice, no, it was actually not there, it was over there. And there was a German professor standing behind me, and he also came out and he said, yes, I think the young man is right, you know. So it gave me the first kind of idea that I knew something, I had a connection there. So because I had been a scribe there, so it was like coming home for me. And I've been there so many other times also. But my calling to the seer was, there was no doubt in my mind that was a special calling that I had to answer. Yes. Okay. All right. Thank you very much for coming.